Hey everybody, it's your professor again, Steve Yano, here to talk to you about one of the readings from Unit 1 of the online argumentation course. If you're in this course, it might help you to try to read the reading first before listening to this lecture about the ideas in this reading. It's the reading that gets my vote for either most difficult or second most difficult reading in the entire unit. And that is Stephen Toulmin's Uses of Argument, Section 1. Most of the time, what they mean by this is Stephen Toulmin's model of argumentation, which is sort of the basic T. This basic T idea is one that came to me from talking to scholar Dr. Barbara Warnick when she was chair of the department at Pitt. She was teaching a course in Toulmin's work and just talked about there's more to Toulmin than the basic T, which is the data, warrant, claim, and those three things in relation. And if you've had any kind of competitive debate training, tournament-oriented debate training, intercollegiate debate training, you're very familiar with that basic T model. But this is not Stephen Toulmin's most important contribution to the study of argumentation. I would say Stephen Toulmin's most important contribution in uses of argument is the separation from the way that people argue in daily life from a philosophical project to purify argumentation or to make argumentation accurate beyond measure, that is, to make argumentation its own ideal. So the practice of argument would have very little distinction from what a good argument is, like in absolute terms. So that project was one that Stephen Toulmin disagreed with. He was much, much more interested in creating a philosophy of argument that was based inductively on how people argue every day. Now, if you've already read part of the section, you'll understand exactly what I mean, is that he's very interested in little contradictions or things that don't make a lot of sense in the way that people argue. In section one that you had to read for class, what he's trying to do is create a theory of argument based on assumptions. And just like the four questions, if you haven't watched that video, go watch that right now. This video will still be here when you get back. The four questions you need to ask of yourself of everything you read for this class. Those four questions are going to come into bear in the things that I'm talking about here with Stephen Toulmin. So here are some things from the reading that I think stand out that I'd like to comment on in this short video. It's not an excuse for not reading the piece. You still need to read the piece because there'll be parts of it that you might disagree with what I say, or there'll be parts of it that I gloss over because I'm really just kind of hitting the highest points of Stephen Toulmin's writing here. This book was written in the 1950s as well. I should say that because parts of it are a little dated and a couple of parts of it you might find to be a little offensive. And to understand the context of where he's coming from, when he's talking about things like the fox hunting and all that, were very common kind of topics in the 50s. He didn't do it to be a jerk, he did it to be understood. And at that time period, no one would have thought controversial the things that he's bringing up. Whether or not they should have felt that those were controversial is a different question. But for us, we could plug in any example that would be meaningful to us, and 80-so years from now, people will make fun of us too. For using examples that are, you know, incorrect or offensive. When we start argument, Toulmin says we start by making an assertion, and the value or the seriousness of that assertion is contextually driven. The value of an assertion is always dependent on who's doing the asserting. How do we know this person? What are their credentials? Where are we? What time of day it is? What's the facility? What's the surrounding? What's the motive for them making this assertion? Everything is contextually taken, and that's a huge difference than the way we might think about argument coming into this class, which is that there are certain people who assert something, it's more true than other people. But that's just very contextually driven. You can imagine situations where someone would make an assertion, and by the fact of where they work or who they work for, you would immediately doubt the persuasiveness of that assertion. He then says that argument is a risk-taking thing, that anytime we argue, we are taking a risk, and I think that's a wonderful way to think. Normally, when we argue, we might have the assumption that we're arguing because we know we're right, and that these dumb people need to be corrected, and these people need to have their minds changed, and all this kind of stuff, and it's just not the case. When you argue, you're taking a huge risk, and I'll ask you, what do you think that risk is? What do you think the risk is involved in argumentation? I think it has something to do with the fact that if you put reasons and evidence forward, you're inviting a person to disagree with the reasons and evidence. And if they say something that makes you doubt the veracity of what you're offering, then you have to question your assumptions too. Most people today don't think of argument that way. They think of it as crusading for the truth or crusading for justice. You have people on the right wing who are supporting a vision that they think is absolutely true and right, and they don't need evidence to support that. On the left wing, it's the same thing. This is the right thing to do for people. This is exactly the way people should live. There's a lot of dictating of ideas, and there's not a lot of risk-taking when you say, hey, here's my idea, I hope you come and agree with me on it. And I think Toulmin's really good in that section about that. The key question for Toulmin is, what do you have to go on? If I assert something to you and say, I think that Hurricane Dorian is one of the most destructive hurricanes we've ever seen formed, then you say, oh yeah, well, what makes you think that? Because I can think off the top of my head of Katrina or Hurricane Andrew or a number of hurricanes that were incredibly destructive. And then you would have to provide some reasoning that gets you there. And that's the risk-taking part. Because you're expressing a belief, but what if you're wrong? Wrongness in argumentation has no relationship to what's true. No relationship at all. At the end of an argument, we say, yeah, that's true, but this can always be something we could change our minds about, or that we could go back on, or that we could think of some other thing about. We can always change our mind. So it's not fidelity to some kind of timeless, everlasting truth. What argumentation is what have you got to go on? What's the evidence that leads you to that belief, and can you convince me that that evidence is good, or that evidence is really the most persuasive? Does that make your statement believable, that assertion believable? His big question for this section, after what have you got to go on, which kind of shows us the kind of amorphous or uncertain ground we're on when we study argumentation, is the idea of, are there universal standards for assessing arguments? What he means by this is there a rule book or a guideline that says these arguments are good and these arguments are bad? Through the course of the semester, you're going to be reading people who say these arguments are good, these arguments are bad. There's a lot of debate about this, ironically enough, in argumentation. And let me take this minute to say that argumentation is a difficult thing to study because you're studying it in terms of itself. That is, there's no neutral place we can stand and study argument. In order to convince you that my ideas about argument are right, I have to make an argument. Now that is a weird thing. There's no distance between the thing I'm studying and what I'm using to study and communicate about it with you. That's a very difficult thing to wrap your head around. The point is, we have to be careful because anything we study about argument isn't necessarily true or absolutely true. We can always change our mind about it. But in order to put forward ideas about argumentation, we have to do it in the terms of argument. There's not a neutral place to do it or to prove that we're right. In order to answer this question about are there universal standards in argument, he says no, but there could be some common areas as we move through it. He comes up with his most important theory of argument, which is the theory of argument fields. Argument fields are basically the idea that the logical content of the argument is of the same type. So scientists argue within an argument field. Those scientific arguments might not have any believability or any relevance outside of a scientific question. The same for sports, the same for teaching, and the same for politics. There are lots of different kinds of arguments that have great weight within their field, but outside of their field, they wouldn't really be convincing. We have to be very vigilantly aware of where it is we're arguing and under what conditions we're arguing, or we're not going to be believed. That's the point here, is that there's no universally good argument or good piece of evidence outside of a field where there's logical consistency or reasonable consistency between the kind of evidence you're providing and between the kind of assertions that you're making. He then wonders, well, does that mean the whole thing is atomized? Does that mean that all arguments are only evaluated within a field? This is patently untrue because people will question arguments made in a court in terms of society. And people will question arguments made in sports in terms of the field. So the field of the argument isn't necessarily the best thing to stop at. That's one of the things that helps understand argument, but what are the things that are invariant? So there's two categories he's going to talk about in the next section. Field invariant parts of argument and field dependent parts of argument. The thing that's the most important to me is the field dependent parts of argument, because I think this is where people make a lot of mistakes in understanding argumentation, is they take what's field dependent and then they try to globalize it. They say, oh, well, that doesn't match up with science, or that's not economic reasoning. And they never question the idea about whether or not those sets of arguments have any kind of purchase outside of the field in which they get their formidable, persuasive ability from. He wonders if perhaps law is a good place to look for a metaphor here, and I think he's right, because the law handles a great variety of cases. That's his argument. He says, look to the law for a kind of a field-invariant way to judge arguments. Now, field-dependent ways to judge arguments are actually kind of easy, because in field dependency, what you do is you look to the standards of that field and what they would count as evidence or good reasoning, and then you can measure up what's going on based on that argument, if you want to judge it based on that. But the field invariant things are like, is this a good argument regardless of the field? That's a very difficult thing to prove. And he says, look to the courts. The courts handle everything from custody to crime to whether or not somebody's owed a lot of money because of harm that came to them. The courts use field invariant practices of evidence. Courtroom evidence is handled by motions. There's certain rules for introducing evidence. So that's something that's invariant there. But in other parts of the world, Toulmin says, in other fields, the evidence would be very variant from field to field. But what counts as evidence in a legal case might not count as evidence in our personal lives. That's why we get so mad at the trials of celebrities when the court refuses to hear something or they're doing all these motions. They're very strict standards because they have this history of doing a variety of different kinds of cases, and they want to make sure that it's done in a sort of a fair way or an equitable way. What's invariant in the court system are the different stages by which we come to make an argument. Stage one, we list the possible candidates for an answer to the question that has us arguing. Of these different possible candidates, some are eliminated right away, like when he talks about President Eisenhower on the Davis Cup team. If somebody suggested something like that, like, oh, for winning the Heisman Trophy in college football, we should recommend President Trump. Everybody would just laugh because it's just ridiculous. That is a possibility, but it is not a probability. And that's the big thing that Toulmin talks about later on in the piece, is that we sometimes confuse what's probable and worth argumentative discussion with what's possible. You hear that a lot in common discourse about arguments, like, well, anything's possible, it could be possible. And that's how we get a lot of conspiracy theory ideas into the political mainstream. Possibility is not what argument deals with. What it deals with is reasonable probability, and that's determined by context, the situation, and the topic. It's field variant. There is no absolute rule for what should be included or excluded from the possibilities of consideration in an argument. What will determine that is probably the most important word you're going to hear me talk about all semester, and that is audience. The audience determines nearly everything in terms of argument and what is good, bad, persuasive, not, and you ignore that as an arguer and a speaker at your own peril. Ignoring the audience means that they might not listen to you at all, and you lose your opportunity to persuade, and you change nobody's mind. So probability is what we're dealing with here, not just because something's possible. That's determined at the beginning of an argument. As people say, well, what about this? And things are laughed out, or people say this. Then you start to look at the evidence between competing probabilities, and as you examine the evidence, some probabilities are removed, others gain greater weight, and that's how the argument proceeds. This is all Toulmin's kind of formulation. If you think about it, a court does it that way too. A charge is applied or a case is brought forward and it's seen to have merit. And if it does have merit in the pretrial motion, then you move to the trial. The trial's had where the evidence is compared and then a decision is made. It's very similar to how we argue with our friends. Like, where do you want to go to lunch? Oh, maybe we could go here. Haha, that place is terrible. What about this place? What about that place? As the possibilities narrow, evidence is brought out and a decision then can be made. One of the things about Toulmin's discussion of field dependence and invariance that's odd to me is the fact that it's so focused on decision making. I think it can be a lot of different things. I think it doesn't necessarily have to be for decision making, but oftentimes when one's having an argument, one's trying to come to agreement with other people. So you're trying to get people to do something you'd like, so it kind of makes sense. But there's also creative and some alternative ways to think about argument that we'll get into in the course of this class, or in the course of the course. Sometimes we find ourselves in weird situations where someone proposes something and we say, yeah, that's exactly right, and there's not much of an argument to be had. Toulmin says these have the shape of arguments, but they might not necessarily be arguments because there's no analysis of the evidence. There's no investigation or comparison of the evidence in these moments. Then there are also moments where no matter how much we compare the evidence, there's no decision is possible, no solving of the question is possible, which he calls the realm of aesthetics. And aesthetics would be arguments about which painting is better, which song is better, which artist is better, which novel is better. And these are things that from your own life experiences, I know that you find hard to resolve. And Toulmin says the reason for that is because we treat them like arguments that need resolution, but they might, aesthetic questions might not be resolvable in this way. But there are also things that happen where somebody says, you know, what are we going to do this weekend? Oh, we're going to play video games and eat a lot of pizza. And you're like, that's it. That's exactly what's going to happen. There's no argument there, but it has the structure of argument because a possibility is brought forward and it's examined, but it's examined very quickly. We might even say that it's not examined at all, that it's just kind of accepted because the possibility of that being the answer is just so tasty. Everyone kind of clicks with it and you just roll on. And I think that's an interesting point. It's kind of an aside, but it is kind of an interesting point about what do you think the limits of argument are. When you say someone's had an argument, if there's quick agreement, is it still an argument or not? It's something worth thinking about, I think. So evidence rules in and out different possibilities. And then you move to the level of qualification, which you might hear people say, well, in a perfect world, or in a world where a Trump is president, or in a world where we have to live in a capitalist order. You hear people make these kind of arguments all the time. These are what they call qualifications. Qualifications are things that mess with the strength of the claim of the possibility. And they also help us test the evidence in different ways. So people might say, well, sure, in a world where everyone had food and clean water, then this would be something we'd want to do. But maybe we'd want to do these other possibilities first. Qualification is an important part of any normal argument process, and it's one that affects the strength of what's being asserted or not. And in Toulmin's later theory, the qualification becomes one of the most important things. We're not really going to get into that in this class, but I might make a video about the Toulmin model if you guys are interested and talk to you about how that's used to analyze arguments. The big mistake most people make with the Toulmin model is they think it's meant to teach people how to generate arguments. It is not. It is a horrible, horrible idea, and it's a really good way to make people think of arguments as mechanical, of only the sum total of their parts, and that they have incredible strength just based on that structure, not based on Toulmin's starting place. The model is still several hundred pages away. The starting place is field dependency and variability and invariability, which is why the model has purchase later down, but it's always within a field that the model works. And people miss that when they teach it. I kind of wish people wouldn't teach the Toulmin model at all and would just teach field dependency and field invariancy as kind of an alternative to that. So, field invariant. The way we move through the argument and put it together seems the same no matter where it is or what it is you're arguing about. Field dependent seems to be evidence, reasons, and explanation. All the meat of the argument is right there. Or if you're a vegetarian or vegan, all the impossible burger part of the argument is right there. That's the place where people want to camp out and talk about argumentation. The process of going through it is something we'll talk about a little bit later when we get to the pragma dialecticians who have different ideas about that. That might be the hardest reading in the section. This one might be the second hardest. Let's talk about some of these examples of how field variance works. The first example is a truck driver has a big steel beam fall off of his truck and he gets out to lift it up and someone says, no, don't pick that up. You can't pick that up. What is it that they're saying? Are they saying it's impossible for the truck driver to pick up that beam? Are they saying he shouldn't do it for health reasons? They're definitely not saying it's impossible for him to do it, because the truck driver can get out and say, I handle these all the time, picks it up and puts it back on his truck. He knows how to handle what looks to be an incredibly heavy steel beam. What do we make of that? What do you make of that? I think what Toulmin's trying to tell us is that when we say things are can't or impossible, what we mean is in terms of a field, in terms of the context in which we approach things. We certainly don't mean that there is no way that this could ever happen. What we mean instead is the conditions and the evidence that I'm seeing makes this possibility a candidate for resolution of the argument. Let's look to the second one. Your friend is putting together a rally. They want to have 10,000 people come and meet in the town hall or in the church. You say, you can't get 10,000 people to this meeting. So yes, I can. I'm very persuasive. But in this case, the context is missed between the two, because the context that you're bringing up is 10,000 people won't fit in that building, whereas the context your friend brings up is one of their persuasive efficacy. Obviously, they're incredibly persuasive. They're your friend. But at the same time, the building won't hold that many people, so that's the issue of where the can't and the impossibility comes from. Third example. Someone is talking about a fox hunt who's never seen one before, and they talk about seeing the tail of the fox. This is not something you're supposed to talk about in fox hunting, apparently. I don't really know anything about fox hunting, but this is a big example, I guess, in the 50s for Toulmin to use. He's also talking to other philosophers and people who are of a certain class at, like, the highest level university kind of scholars and thinkers. So maybe it has something to do with class distinction. But the point here is impropriety. You might think as a counterexample of this is that you're never supposed to wish an actor good luck backstage. You're always supposed to say, break a leg. And backstage in a theater, you're never supposed to mention Shakespeare's play, Macbeth. You're supposed to say, that Scottish play. And these are things that are about tradition and propriety. Obviously, you can go backstage and talk about Macbeth all you want and wish everyone good luck while you do so. But that would be incredibly, incredibly rude, and it would be a violation of cultural norms and what's expected culturally. It would be seen as indecorous. And so you wouldn't want to do that. So when someone says you can't talk about the Foxtail or you can't talk about that Scottish play, what they're saying is obviously, you know, you can, but that can't is different. It's field dependent. It's field variant. Based on where you are, you're not able to talk about that. Just like the other examples, you can't lift that beam. That's dependent on the field of normal human strength and not familiarity with what that person is able to do in their job. The 10,000 people in the town hall is based on the dependency of the venue and how many people it can hold. And the last one, the one that we just did, is about propriety. The next example he does is the author who's writing about the male sister. He said, you cannot have a male sister in a book. Yes, I can. I write page and page and pages after it. He even concedes that if someone had had gender reassignment surgery, that they still would not be a sister at that point. They'd be a brother. In this day and age, this is not the best example because people can identify however they want, male, female, brother, sister. We're having an open conversation nationally about gender pronouns and about identification with gender and sex. So it's not the best example, but the point here is confusing based on common usage. So if the common usage for something is to call someone a sister or a brother, and you don't do that, you use some other term or you use it in a confusing way, that's something you shouldn't do because it impedes understanding. I'm sure Toulmin would agree that this example is not a great one for today because of the ongoing national discussion about gender and about sex and about identity. But the point is still there that you want to use the terms in a way that doesn't increase confusion because you want adherence and agreement to your argument. The final thing we'll talk about in this reading is the difference between force and criteria. This might be a little confusing. So force is field invariant. That is, when I say you cannot do it, you're wrong, this is a bad idea. The force of that, depending on where you are, it doesn't change. It still means the same thing. You're wrong, this is bad, this can't be done. It's an unacceptable probability. But the criteria is what's supporting the claim, and that is field variant. Certain kinds of support don't work well in other venues, much to the chagrin of popular scientists you might see on Twitter, like Neil deGrasse Tyson and others, where they will say that scientific reasoning is the best way to make all decisions. They don't understand the idea that in argumentation, the criteria changes based on the field. That is, if I want to make the point of whether someone can or can't do something, I need to explain the criteria in terms of the situation, in terms of the context. This is why you have a lot of, any doctor will tell you, you have a lot of scientific information about health that no patient should really know about, because it just doesn't apply to them in the context of their life, their age, all these things. So this is the debate that's happening in the United States about advertisements for prescription drugs. You give a lot of information to a patient and they think, oh, this drug is gonna help me. This drug is really gonna deal with the issues that I have. It's gonna make me feel better. But the doctor knows better the context and judges medicine by the context of the patient, how old they are, their weight, their height, their previous illnesses, what their diet's like, what their exercise schedule is like, what their stress level is like. All of these things factor into whether or not someone should take a drug, and that's left out in the drug company commercial in hopes that the people will not understand that scientific evidence is field dependent. The force of an argument, you should take this medicine, that applies no matter where you are, but the reasons why you should take it might be very, very different, and that's something that's hard to wrap your head around. So just think about it like this. The evidence and the things you'd use to shore up the what have you got to go on for your claim in an argument or your assertion, those are going to change based on who you're talking to, what you're talking about, who you're talking with, what's the field of the argument. The invariance is going to be the process by which one goes through arguing, and that's going to stay the same. So when you say something about this is true or this is the best plan, that's field invariant, but what it takes to be true is going to change based on the situation. That's pretty much all I wanted to say about this reading, the Stephen Toulmin reading of Section 1. Let me know your questions. You can leave a comment or go to the Discord and leave a comment there if you're in the class. And let me know what you think, and let me know if there's anything that's unclear about field dependency and field variance, or field invariant and field variance, which is what he calls it. But most Americans call field dependency as argumentation. The most important thing to take away from this discussion is that argumentation has no universal rule book. It has things that will make sense across different contexts, but what proves an argument true is always in flux. What makes an argument persuasive is always in flux. And that's something that's always dependent on who you're speaking to, under what conditions, and about what. The evidence that works well in a sports context does not work well in a scientific context, necessarily. I mean, there's sports medicine. So think about it in terms of what do you think in argument are things that are universal ways to judge a bad and good argument? And then what are the things that are flexible? What are the ways that bad and good argument are judged that change from situation to situation? All right, well, thanks for watching this. I hope it helped you understand Toulmin's uses of argument, Section 1. There's a ton of other videos here for all the other readings, so take a look, but read the readings first and try to answer the four questions before watching the videos. I think it'll make the videos a little bit more helpful.